Before you watch this video, please note that there is some mention and imagery that may be disturbing to some. Please watch at your own risk. Utaho no Tatari, or The Curse of Utaho in English, is an obscure Japanese game that remained untranslated for many years, leaving many curious as to what happens within the game and what exactly is Utaho's curse. Now that the game is translated into English, many people have played the game, still finding the plot and lore confusing. And that's absolutely understandable. The first game doesn't do a great job explaining any of the lore. It takes playing and obtaining all of the endings in the sequel of Utaho no Tatari for some, not all, of the lore and story to be explained. Because of this, some of this video will be my speculation as to what happened, using the evidence from the game to back my theories. Of course, if you have a different theory, please let me know in the comments below. And while I may be hard on these games, I still really enjoy them. They are very B-movie horror, but if you go into these games with this in mind, I think you'll have a lot of fun with the odd enemies, creepy atmosphere, and dark lore. Just to note, all game footage and videos I used for this video, as well as download links for both the Japanese and English versions of the game if you'd like to play these games yourself, will be in the description below. So now let's deep dive into the confusing and sometimes frustrating lore and explain the story of Utaho no Tatari and the fate of the Yamano family. The game opens with a black screen. White text comes on the screen that translates to, "The following paragraph is an excerpt from a diary written by the family's eldest daughter." It says, "There are some truths in this world you should never learn. I learned one of those truths. Because I now know it, I will end my life. No one should learn the truth, because it is a cursed truth. You who read this, please don't search for the truth, and don't ask for it. A disturbing foreshadowing of what is to come." And with that, we start with Chapter 1, The Yamano Family Residence. August 20th, 1997. A young girl is watching TV with her father. She is introduced as the younger sister, Rino. Her and her father, Ryuto, laugh along with the show as they watch. Overall, a sweet scene of a father and daughter spending time together. As the scene fades to black, Utaho explains that this is what everyday life was like for her family. It was peaceful and pleasant. Until one day, when everything changed. Suddenly, the scene changes to the kitchen of the family home. Utaho, Rino's older sister and the main protagonist, runs into the room and up to her mother, who is preparing dinner. Utaho is hungry, but her mother isn't done making dinner yet. So she sends Utaho off to find Utaho's grandmother, who is late returning from cleaning the shrine. Utaho agrees, going to her grandmother's room to check on her grandmother. When Utaho calls out and gets no response from her grandmother, she goes into the room, only to find that her grandmother is gone. Following that day, strange things began to happen all around them. Utaho gets home later than usual and notices that her father and sister are also still gone, which she finds odd, since she was late getting back herself. Then she enters her home, the Yamano household. Utaho doesn't know it, but this will be the worst night of her life. When Utaho enters her home, she notices that she doesn't see or hear her mother. When she searches around, she finds the house completely empty. Odd. Rino, her younger sister, isn't there either, which again is very odd because it's so late. Searching the bathroom for clues, Utaho is horrified to find her mother inside, dead. Utaho is terrified, sickened, and struck with unimaginable grief at the sight. It's immediately obvious to her that her mother's death wasn't an accident. As Utaho flees the bathroom, the reflection of a strange young woman with white hair flashes in the bathroom mirror before the mirror shatters, replaced by leaking blood. It seems something supernatural was happening, but what could it be, and why target Utaho's family? And where is Utaho's sister? Utaho races around the house, trying to find her. She even checks her father's study, which should be empty since, supposedly, her father is at work. However, inside is her father, also dead. Utaho is struck with dread. How is this happening? Why is it happening to her family? Where is her sister? Stepping out of the room, Utaho finds her sister, Rino. Utaho is flooded with relief. Maybe this was all just a bad dream. Maybe she imagined it. But when Rino runs away from her and into her room, Utaho hurries to follow her. When Utaho steps inside, her sister faces towards the wall, refusing to look at Utaho when Utaho calls out to her. When Utaho gets close enough, Rino turns around. wearing a no mask. Reno repeats, save me, over and over again before her neck snaps and her body contorts into an unnatural form. Utaho screams, fleeing from Reno's room in horror. What is going on? Utaho doesn't know. However, she did get a hint in the way of Reno's diary, where she left some research she was doing. The research is from a religious researcher, Kaisho Eme, discussing the odd psychic phenomena that's been happening around Utaho and her family since her grandmother's sudden disappearance. The research brings up the household's belief in the Utaho religion, which is a very rare religion in Japan. So rare, in fact, that it was only practiced in an isolated, obscure village in Japan called the Utaho Village. And this village was so isolated that it fell outside of Japanese laws, instead handling all affairs of criminal activity and justice within the village. And though it was rumored that many strange accidents happened in the village, no further reports left the village, so no one actually knows what happened or what the accidents were. As you can imagine, this made it so the goings-on in the village stayed in the village. There must have been a reason why they tried to keep things so quiet, but no one knows. Now, there isn't much that the note tells us about the Utaho religion, since it is so obscure and undocumented, but what we do know is that the Utaho faith is only practiced in the village or by people who once lived in the village, like Utaho's family. Their god is called the Utaho god, and it seems they have very specific rituals in place to honor their god. What those rituals are, though, are unknown. Any other details of the religion are gone, since the location of the village is unknown to the world at large. A rumor spread that the village eventually sank under a dam that was built as part of the Shinmachi Reform Project, which we'll talk about in just a minute. Either way, the location of the village is unknown, leaving it shrouded in mystery. The only surviving part of the village, a few documents from the village that were not destroyed because of the construction, are locked away in a building built by the Shinmachi Reform Project. But what is this reform project? Well, Shinmachi, or New City, Reform Project was the idea to take the isolated and desolate area in and surrounding the Utaho village and reform it into a thriving city. This would include demolishing areas around the village and replacing them with a touristy hotel, a clinic, and a factory. More buildings were going to be added at a later date, including a large hospital with a gynecology wing to accommodate the female population in the area. To help completely erase the village's decrepit and dated image, the new construction was based around Western architecture, which was the exact opposite of the isolated village. Unfortunately, these grandiose plans fail only 3 years after construction is completed on multiple buildings. So what happened? Why did they spend all that money only to throw it all away? Well, like the village, the truth is shrouded in mystery. What is rumored to have happened is that a horrible accident occurred in the hotel, harming many of the guests and workers of the hotel. Afraid of further accidents occurring, the Shinmachi Reform Project comes to an abrupt halt, closing their hotel, factory, and clinic, leaving them mere echoes of what they were supposed to be. But Utaho has a clue of where to go if she wants the truth to what happened to her family. Reno left a note specifically about the hotel. If she goes there now, she might find a reason why all this happened. But first, Utaho goes into one final room, her grandmother's room. You see, Utaho was forbidden from ever entering her grandmother's room, but considering the circumstances, Utaho feels she has no choice. Her grandmother's room is very traditionally Japanese, with tatami mats and sliding doors. However, oddly, the grandmother has a ladder that goes up to the attic. While Utaho searches her grandmother's room, she hears thumping sounds up in the attic, so she decides to go check it out. Who knows? It could be her missing grandmother. Maybe she knows what's going on. Utaho goes up the ladder, only to find nothing inside. No grandmother, no explanation, just a mirror with a talisman on it. When Utaho approaches the mirror, it shatters, startling her. A red no mask, just like the one her sister was wearing, flashes in front of Utaho, causing her to run downstairs. Could the mirror, the red no mask, and what happened to her family be connected? Utaho won't know until she goes to the hotel, so Utaho heads to the front door, but not before the lights in the house flash on and off. In the dark, a hand touches Utaho's shoulder, causing her to scream before it disappears. Though we don't know exactly who or what that was, we do know that that thing probably killed Utaho's family, and it had a very good chance to kill Utaho just then, but didn't. For some reason, for now anyway, it wants Utaho to live. So finally, Utaho leaves the house. Now here the player has two choices. They can send Utaho to the hotel alone, or go to the police station and let the police handle the investigation. Going to the police will end the game with Utaho never finding out the truth, but considering what she's about to go through, maybe it's best that Utaho chooses this option. However, to continue the game, the player must go to the Shinmachi Reform Hotel. And with that, Chapter 2, The Hotel Begins. When Utaho arrives at the hotel, she first notices how Western the interior design is, a choice that was mentioned in Reno's research notes. Utaho starts by searching the first two floors of the hotel, the only ones available to her. She goes on finding keys and unlocking locked rooms. Eerie things begin to happen around her, but Utaho is determined to learn the truth, so she pushes forward anyway. In one of the rooms she unlocks, Utaho finds a yellowed hotel pamphlet. The pamphlet highlights the high-end and Western design of the hotel, as well as noting the hotel has six floors and a middle passageway, which will become important later. Utaho later enters the staff room, one of the most important rooms in the game. Inside are empty shelves, which look like they were emptied in a hurry, and a hole in the middle of the floor. When Utaho approaches the hole in the floor, a giant creature surfaces, only peeking its head out to watch Utaho. However, when Utaho steps too close, it quickly sinks back into the hole, as if, for now anyway, it only wants to watch Utano's movements. In this room are two very important notes. The first is the hotel construction design plans. These plans describe why the reform project chose this area for construction. Like I previously mentioned, they wanted to tap into the isolated and untouched potential the area in and around the village held. They wanted to bring new life and money to the area. Money for this project came from the creator of the Shinmachi Reform Project and the hotel construction collaborators. The second note is the hotel construction plan, or the torn blueprint for the hotel. The most important part of this note is when it lists the main contributors for the opening of the hotel. Listed, among others, is Yuri Yamano, Utaho's great-grandmother. So we know that Utaho's family practiced an obscure faith that is tied to the Utaho village, and that her great-grandmother was a part of the construction of the Shinmachi Reform Hotel, which according to this document, the village had a hand in. But how did these two connect to the curse? And why is the curse only now attacking Utaho and her family after so many decades of remaining dormant? In the back of the room is a door that leads to the basement. For now, Utaho can't enter because of a sign blocking the door, warding anyone away. It says, "Don't enter," and "Don't ask why you can't enter. It's best if you don't know." Foreboding. And a sign that whatever was going on in the basement is something the creators of the hotel wanted to hide. But Utaho needs to get down there. The power breaker to the elevators is down there, and with the elevator's power off, Utaho cannot explore past the second floor. With no other choice, Utaho heads back upstairs, only to find the word basement scratched into a table in a room. This is something you'll see pretty frequently with this game, unfortunately. In an attempt to pad the game for more playtime, the game will send you to one side of the hotel, only to give you a hint to then go to the exact opposite side of the hotel to get an item to return to the very place you started. So imagine it like going from A to D, right back to A, and that happens over and over and over again. It's a bit frustrating, but it's something that was common for RPG Maker games at this time, and it is still something that's common to see even in modern games. It doesn't make it any less annoying though. So Utaho has to explore the rooms until she finds a key to the breaker, then head back downstairs and into the basement. Inside is a breaker, as well as a row of showers, rusted from lack of use and leaking water. In the middle of the room is a bloody chair, knocked on its side. While not a definitive answer as to what was going on in the basement, it's a good clue. It seems that those supposed accidents at the hotel weren't actually accidents, but what were they doing down here to the employees and guests of the hotel? And why were they doing it? For now, we don't know, but the elevators are back on. The other four floors can now be explored by Utaho. Going up to the newly unlocked third floor, Utaho can find children's drawings scattered on the floor. They start out innocent enough, with one being a red creature with one eye saying, "Be my friend," while another has a green head saying, "Hello." And though the red, one-eyed creature seems innocent enough, just something a young child would draw, Utaho sees a hallucination of a bloody dead body, with what looks to be one of its eyes missing. I don't think this is a coincidence, especially considering something nefarious was happening at the hotel. Could the child that drew these drawings be seeing hallucinations of the previous victims of the basement, or maybe even seeing the victims themselves? The green head is also referenced later in the game as a hallucination an adult who checked themselves into the reform clinic reported seeing. So these creatures are not just figments of a child's imagination, and instead are something much more, and perhaps something much more sinister. Either way, this gives us a hint onto what accidents had been happening at the hotel. Something much more sinister was happening than what was let on, and it seems Utaho Village is at the root of the cause. The next drawing Utaho finds depicts an eye looking upward as "Save Me" is written in red across the page, much like what Reno said to Utaho back in the family home. So whatever happened to Reno probably happened to the child that drew these pictures. It's a sickening realization. When Utaho heads up to the sixth floor, in one of the rooms is a young woman with white hair. She looks familiar, but Utaho can't place her quite yet. Utaho tries to question the woman, trying to find out what she's doing in an abandoned hotel of all places, but she refuses to answer. Instead, she tells Utaho she's playing hide and seek. Utaho is rightfully confused, wondering who else is in the hotel whom she could be playing with, but the woman refuses to elaborate, telling Utaho if she wants to know who she's playing hide and seek with so badly, she should go to the Japanese style room on the third floor. The mysterious woman then leaves the room. Definitely a strange encounter. This hotel has been abandoned for decades. There is no reason for anyone else to be here unless they're somehow connected to the hotel or the things that happened in the hotel. But for now, we simply don't know. If Utaho heads to the place she was told to go, she finds a Japanese doll hiding in the closet. That's odd. Why is this doll hidden away in an empty closet of all places? Did someone put it here? Now, if Utaho leaves the room and re-enters, then interacts with the doll again, the doll will triple in size and chase Utaho around the room, suggesting this thing isn't just a doll, but some supernatural being. So this was the thing the mysterious woman was playing hide and seek with? But why? And who is she? Well, we simply don't have those answers right now. To find out more, Utaho must continue searching. Now, if Utaho leaves this room and goes into another room on the same floor, she'll find a bloody figure that whispers, "The doll attacked the doll," before it becomes silent. So I guess we now know what the doll would have done if it had gotten its hands on Utaho. But thankfully, that didn't happen. Finally, Utaho gets onto the fifth floor that had been previously locked and gets another key. And you're going to hear me say this a lot, even though I've cut out a majority of it. And then she goes back to the sixth floor. When she unlocks a new room and goes inside, she sees something horrific. Three people are inside, all dead, in the exact same way her father was. As horrific as it is, there has to be a connection here. Here, Utaho picks up a videotape she can watch, and more importantly, a note from the dead researchers. They mention how there was something odd happening at the hotel, something so odd they weren't sure if it was reality or just an illusion. However, curiosity got the better of them and they set up cameras around the hotel, trying to catch whatever was happening on camera. However, instead of catching whatever was in the hotel, it caught them, and they paid for it with their lives. More victims, just like Utaho's family. Utaho is almost done at the hotel. She just has to decide on where to go from here and who to trust. If Utaho goes into one final room, she'll be tasked with putting the children's drawings that she found earlier in frames on the wall. Once she's done, the Japanese doll she found earlier will be waiting for her by the door. She tells Utaho that the other one is fake and she's the real one. Now, we can assume that the doll is talking about the mysterious young woman we met earlier when she says the other one is fake. And though Utaho has all the reasons in the world not to trust this doll, she's given a choice. She can either believe the doll or not believe it. Now, depending on what the player chooses has a direct effect on the rest of the gameplay, with each choice taking you to a different location and giving you a different ending. This is one part of the game that I thoroughly enjoyed. Getting to this part, only to replay and be sent to a whole new area, was really cool actually. However, I do find that both areas are a bit underdeveloped. I think the idea is fascinating though, and with a little more time and work, it could have been executed really well. Anyway, for the first ending, we are choosing to believe the doll. Don't worry though, we will come back to select the other choice in a little bit. At this point, the doll thanks you before it tells you to tear it apart, revealing a broken doll vocalizer, which the doll was using to speak, and a hotel key. When Utaho uses the key she got on another room, a map for the Shinmachi Reform Clinic is inside. This is an obvious sign of where to go next. Now Utaho just needs to leave the hotel. But it seems that won't be so easy. When Utaho steps out, the mysterious woman is waiting for her, obviously angry. When Utaho tries to tell her off, the woman says, "The truth about you is hell. I am here to make you see the truth." Though it can be difficult to make sense of what she means at this point, it's immediately obvious Utaho got too close to this hellish truth, and because of that, she isn't planning to let Utaho leave the hotel alive. As Utaho runs for her life, the woman chases, but by some miracle, Utaho is able to make it to the front door of the hotel. As Utaho runs away from the hotel, the woman calls out to Utaho, begging her not to go as she tries to catch her. So, who is this woman? Well, we really don't know that yet. What we do know, though, is that this woman knows a lot more than she's letting on, and for some reason, she doesn't want Utaho to know what she knows. She's so desperate to keep the truth hidden, she's even willing to kill Utaho to keep it that way. As we play further, we'll learn a little bit more about her character, but for now, we head to the Shinmachi Reform Clinic. And that begins Chapter 3. Though Utaho is unsettled by what happened, she's determined to learn the truth of what happened to her family. She won't leave the clinic until she has answers. One of the first documents inside the clinic that Utaho can find is a medical examination chart. And while, yes, it is a violation of patients' rights for Utaho to be snooping on this, I think we can all agree that Utaho's in a little too deep to worry about that now. Different names are listed, names we'll see later, and different symptoms they were experiencing when they visited the clinic. Symptoms include a curse, continuous headaches, nausea, a psychological disorder, auditory hallucinations, which include seeing a green face, and fever from construction. The last name, Yayoi Nanako, had their symptoms covered with the words "I'm not bad" written repeatedly in red ink. This is something that Rino, or whatever looks like her, tells Utaho constantly whenever she appears, meaning there is a connection to whatever happened to Rino and the patients at the clinic. But that's not where the connections end. Do you remember the green face? The child in the hotel also had a drawing of a green face. So it seems these hallucinations coming from the supposed curse were spreading to all the Shinmachi Reform buildings. Another interesting thing to note is fever from construction. If they're discussing construction, they must mean construction from the Shinmachi Reform Plan, meaning that these people almost likely had a connection to the Reform Project or the Utaho Village itself. In the most interesting twist, though, we later learn that all the names listed on this document are villagers from the Utaho Village, so the curse wasn't only affecting people part of the Shinmachi Reform Project, but the literal villagers themselves. Utaho is getting closer to the truth, but there's still a lot left unanswered, so Utaho must continue her search. When she goes upstairs and into an unlocked room, the doll vocalizer suddenly begins making noise. When Utaho makes out what it's saying, it says, "I'll tell you something. Search under the bed. Know the truth." Thank God, we're finally going to get the truth. All Utaho's suffering will be for something. Utaho checks under the one bed that stands out, because it's the only one that has a bloody outline of a person on it. And she finds a key. Okay, not the worst thing to find, but not exactly the truth. Either way, it's an hint on where to go. The key unlocks the locker room, and true to its name, it's a room full of lockers. Most of the lockers won't open, but as Utaho keeps exploring, she finds a very old newspaper article on the ground. The newspaper article is torn and stained, but what can be made out from it is that the Utaho Village got pulled into the construction for the Shinmachi Reform Plan, but as the plan kept expanding due to its success, the village was left behind. That means that Yuri, Utaho's great-grandmother, must have joined the Reform Project to help her village. However, as the Reform Project got bigger and made more money, the plan creators left the village behind. As you can probably imagine, this didn't sit well with the villagers. This doesn't explain why the villagers themselves were also getting sick from the curse, though. But at least we do know that the curse was created in the village, killing everyone who had any association with the clinic, hotel, or the factory that was built. This is why the employees and guests at the hotel were getting killed. They were innocent people that were just in the wrong place at the wrong time. And the curse was horrible. Seeing hallucinations, getting violently ill, headaches, all before a horrible, painful death. The deaths were investigated, but how do you stop a curse? Well, you have to stop it at the source, it seems, which meant shutting down all the buildings constructed because of the Shinmachi Reform Project, and forever hiding the original source of the curse itself, the Utaho village. But if anyone who stayed at the hotel is cursed, does that mean that Utano is now cursed? I mean, she went in and spent time in the hotel. She also saw all those odd hallucinations. But how does she stop the curse now? To find out, Utano must keep exploring, and when she does, the doll's vocalizer begins making noise again, catching Utano's attention. It warns Utano to be careful. Alright, that's unsettling, but there's nothing left in here but a locked locker, so Utano needs to explore other parts of the clinic. When Utano steps out of the locker room, the doll's vocalizer goes off again. Now this scene is disturbing, but it doesn't make much sense right now. It wasn't until I played the second game that I was able to connect the dots, so to speak. But don't worry, I won't make you wait until the second game to explore the scene. So let's break the scene down. First, a mother says, "Stop, there is nothing wrong with that child." It seems that someone or a group is trying to take this woman's child away. For some reason, they believe this child is dangerous and needs to be removed. Then, what we can assume to be the child in question, cackles evilly before pleading with their mother for help. Finally, the mother pleads, saying, "Please, don't," before screaming. So it seems whatever the other person or group was worried about was a valid concern, and the mother paid the ultimate price for trying to protect her child. It seems this child is possessed, most likely by the curse. Now this is speculation on my part, but I believe this is Reno, Utano's sister, and their mom. Out of their family, Reno was the only one who supposedly survived the encounter with the curse, not counting Utano. But we saw in the home that that wasn't exactly true. Something has been using Reno's body to keep an eye on Utano and constantly mock and manipulate her as well. But Reno has moments of clarity, such as when she begs Utano to save her. It's a devastating revelation. The curse has possessed Reno and is using her to manipulate Utano. Why go through all the trouble? And poor Reno, this is a fate worse than death, especially since she has moments of clarity. More pieces to the puzzle of what happened are being revealed, but it still doesn't make sense. Utano must keep going. This time, this is what it says. Unlike the previous scene, this one is happier, at least at first. A woman must be pregnant or getting married since she says she's expanding her family, and she seems genuinely excited for it. However, something horrible happens. This one I had a much harder time putting together. What makes it more difficult is we don't know exactly who is speaking and when they are speaking. The biggest problem, it seems, is that the woman is pregnant or getting married. Now, why would this be a problem? Is this somehow helping the spread of the curse? Is this woman from the Utaho village? Unfortunately, we don't have answers to these questions. This one genuinely has me stumped. What I think, which again is pure speculation, is that this woman's from the Utaho village. She is pregnant by way of her being cited for her happy little family. But somehow, her pregnancy ties to the curse, and the person who attacks her is trying to stop all avenues of the curse spreading. Again, this is pure speculation. If you have any other ideas, please let me know. Either way, Utano continues exploring and finds another key in a pool of blood, a key to a locked locker. However, before she can leave, the doll's vocalizer goes off one more time to quickly say, "That girl is evil." What girl? Well, I'm still not sure about this either. It's wildly up to speculation. It could be Utano, Reno, the young one from the hotel, someone else entirely. However, I think I know who it is. I believe that this evil girl is a young woman from the hotel. Now, we don't know exactly who she is yet, or what role she plays in the story, but we know that she's trying to hide the truth of the Utaho curse, and she's even willing to kill people to keep it hidden. However, we also know that she won't attack or hurt people unless she has to, since she didn't attack Utano when they first met, even though she easily could have. It wasn't until Utano got too close to the truth that she tried to kill Utano. If that's the case, it would make sense that she would be the one on the recordings harming people. These people got too close to the truth about the curse, so she stopped them. For now, Utano heads back to the locker room and straight to the locked locker. Inside, to Utano's horror, is the head of her deceased mother. A horrific reminder of what she has been through and will continue to go through. Also inside is a key to the door to the basement, which Utano grabs before slamming the locker shut. Utano is shaken, But she's come so far, and she's so close to the truth. She must go down to the basement and learn the truth. The basement of the clinic is eerie and dark. Something feels off about the whole place. Just like the hotel, something nefarious was happening here. If Utaho heads into the room on the left, the body of Reno will be inside on a medical table, a white sheet covering her face, signifying she is dead. Utaho cries for her sister, but suddenly Reno's bones begin to crack before she jumps off the table. Utaho knows something horrible will happen if Reno gets too close, so she keeps her distance, running out of the room as soon as the opportunity presents itself. If Utaho enters the room on the right, she finds something is trapped under the grate. It mumbles and groans as she approaches. Under the grate is a person's face, pressing itself against the grate in hopes Utaho will save whoever it once was. It is a disturbing hint that the curse wasn't the only thing harming innocent people. Finally, Utaho enters the room at the end of the hall. Inside the small room are four bloody beds. The fate of anyone who ended up here is horrific. In the middle of those beds is a red no mask. The same red no mask that has been terrorizing Utaho since the beginning, and it's the same one Reno was wearing after she was possessed. This is what harmed Reno and caused such grief to her family. This is the curse of Utaho. But Utaho still needs the truth. Why did this all happen? Why her family? The no mask answers by saying, "The curse is upon you, dear. You and your entire family will die." So it's true. Utaho is now cursed with the same curse everyone else was cursed by. It's what caused her family to die. The curse is the truth, it says. By getting too close to the truth, you will curse yourself. But the no mask refuses to say what the truth behind the curse is. We've speculated so far, but we haven't been able to confirm any of it yet. Unfortunately, this is a dead end. As if mocking Utaho one last time, the no mask manifests an embodiment of Reno in front of Utaho. But Utaho has confronted at least this truth. Reno is dead, and this thing is using her image to toy with Utaho. But Utaho will not be toyed with anymore. She slaps the figment away, realizing that none of this is real, which causes it to screech horribly before it disappears. Well, that's one problem taken care of, but Utaho still has to deal with the no mask, which suddenly turns into a large red head with no eyes. So Utaho wasn't speaking to the curse after all, but something else that pretended to be the curse. Most likely another victim that tried to scare Utaho away before she got too close to the truth. But it's too late now. Finally, the head tells Utaho if she wants the truth so badly, it will show her the truth, most likely dooming her to a fate similar to its own. It grows annoyed when Utaho steps back, mocking her by questioning if she really wanted the truth. Utaho then runs for her life, dodging the giant head as it follows her out of the basement. Through speed and luck, Utaho manages to get to the front door and out to safety. The first thing Utaho decides, now that she is safe, is to go to the police. She's gotten too close to the truth. It's time someone else tried to find out the truth. However, in a turn of events Utaho did not expect, she is arrested on the spot on the suspicion of murdering her family. With Utaho's last breath, she tells anyone who will listen to not look for the truth. Don't ask for it. This is Utaho's fate. I hope that the face at the end seems familiar. It's a young woman from the hotel. As she screeches with laughter, you can safely assume the worst for Utaho's fate. But this can't be how it ends. There is so much left unanswered, and it doesn't have to be. Let's roll back the clock, going all the way back to the hotel, to the Japanese doll. This time, instead of trusting the doll, Utaho tells the doll she doesn't believe it. The doll screams, but you can't interact with it further, so Utaho leaves. This time, when Utaho heads for the elevators, instead of getting a key to a door near the elevators opens on its own. Inside the room are the talismans Utaho saw in her home and a single TV, its screen glowing red. On the screen it says, "Take me with you. Everyone has gone to the basement. They won't come back." This is strange. The construction plan doesn't match the actual drawing. The size of the basement is clearly different. This is my contribution. I participated in the Shimachi Reform Project by killing people. So with this, we get closer to the truth. While there certainly seems to be a curse, it seems the villagers were also killing people. But for what purpose? Was it to calm their god and its curse? Or was it something entirely separate? And whatever they were doing, they hid their deeds in the basement of the hotel. The bloody chair is only a hint of the horrible crimes that they were committing. However, if Utaho goes down to the basement, she'll note that something feels off about the wall behind the chair, but nothing else. There is nothing, as far as I know, that the player can do to learn more about what's behind the wall. For now, this is a mystery. Maybe one best left unanswered. For the rest of our questions, there's only one place left that we can go. The Utaho village. But we still don't know the location of the village. Remember, its exact location has been lost to history, with many assuming the village doesn't even exist anymore. If Utaho wants to get to the village, she's going to have to find a map or something else that reveals the location of the village. If Utaho returns to the room with the children's drawings and the screeching doll, the room will now be covered completely in blood. The drawings themselves have also changed, now covered in blood while saying eerie things like "I'm coming" or "Uta." When Utaho leaves, she will then head to the fifth floor, where she gets a hint about where the young mysterious woman is. She seems to know a lot about what's going on. Maybe she can help Utaho. This is a scene that plays out when Utaho enters the bloody elevator on the fifth floor. When Utaho approaches the young woman, now covered in blood, Utaho finds her mother's necklace. While Utaho is confused how this woman got her mother's necklace, it confirms to us that this woman did indeed kill Utano's mother. There is no other explanation, especially when you consider the fact that she has Utano's mother's necklace, and she appeared in the mirror immediately after Utaho finds her mother's body for the first time. I think this also answers, finally, what happened to Utano's family. Somehow, the grandmother, most likely while cleaning the shrine that's mentioned at the beginning of the game, accidentally stumbled upon the curse of Utaho. Because of this, she flees, never returning home. Maybe like Utaho, she tried to find a cure for the curse. Either way, somehow, Reno begins to look into the family religion, the religion of Utaho. Maybe she started researching as a way to help find the missing grandmother, but when Reno does this, she accidentally stumbles upon the curse as well. We know that the curse spreads by more people learning about it, so Reno probably showed her family her findings and shared more about it with them. Reno, without even realizing it, doomed her family at that moment. Reno was possessed by the curse as a vessel to further spread the curse. The father was most likely possessed, but quickly eliminated, just like the researchers in the hotel. For whatever reason, it seems the curse moves from one person to another and gets rid of any extra people, which would have been Utaho and Reno's mom and dad. However, the mysterious woman from the hotel seems to have caught wind of what was happening and killed Reno's mother to try to stop the spread of the curse as much as possible. It's probably too late for the woman to get to Reno though, since Reno is already dead and most likely just a bodily shell for the curse to use. This still doesn't explain why the curse has let Utaho live for as long as it has, but my guess is that the curse is using Utaho to have spread the curse further. It is manipulating her with illusions of Reno and a need for the truth to spread the curse to more unsuspecting victims. It's much easier to spread a curse with someone alive running around spreading the news about it than a possessed shell of a person. But this still doesn't answer the question, who is this mysterious woman? Well, I think we can all agree that this isn't a living, breathing person, though there's a very good chance that she once was. From how passionately she fights a curse, she must be a victim of it. But for more information, we'll have to wait. This was already a huge revelation in itself. Utaho is then given the map to the Utaho village, and with that, Utaho safely leaves the hotel without issue. It's as if the hotel is now completely abandoned. Whatever that was once living here, now gone. As Utaho looks over the map to get to the village, she quickly realizes she'll need a car to get there. Walking through the forest near the hotel, she spots a taxi parked on the side of the road. Utaho is confused why a taxi is out in the middle of nowhere, but the taxi driver explains that they just dropped a customer off. In the middle of nowhere. In a forest. Utaho then asks about the Utaho village, to which the taxi driver immediately responds they know the way to get there. The village that's location is supposedly hidden and only whispered about in rumors. The village that Utaho needed a map to find. This taxi driver just miraculously knows the way? Okay. Well, yes, it is very suspicious, but Utaho feels she has no choice. So, against her better judgment, she gets in the taxi, heading for the Utaho village. As the taxi driver drives them towards the village, he makes small talk with Utaho. At first, it's innocuous enough, but their conversation quickly turns strange when Utaho asks about who he just dropped off. He responds with, "A woman. She had business to attend to at the hotel." Utaho is immediately alarmed. There's only one woman she could think of that would go to the abandoned hotel. Needing more clues, Utaho asks the driver who it was, but he refuses to answer, only saying that, like Utaho, that woman is cursed. Utaho knows she needs to get out of this taxi immediately. As quietly as possible, she unbuckles her seatbelt. He then asks Utaho again if she's cursed, saying the other woman is cursed too. The taxi suddenly enters a long, pitch-black tunnel. As Utaho screams and tries to escape, the taxi driver repeats the word cursed over and over again. Utaho jumps out of the taxi, hurting her arm in the process, but otherwise unharmed. Then she notices the road they were heading towards is now gone, like a Japanese version of Silent Hill. If Utaho did not jump out when she did, she would have gone into the ravine with the driver. The other direction is way back home, but even if Utaho wanted to turn back now, it's too late. She must continue forward to the village. Utaho climbs through a small hole in the wall, the only way to the village. And with that, we start the next chapter, Utaho Village. When Utaho steps out, she's in a foggy field. In front of her, Utaho finds a black and white map, which she takes with her. The map is torn up with red marks all over the page, but Utaho takes it anyway, hoping it will be useful later. Eventually, Utaho finds a door that she needs to get through to get to the village. It says it will open for her if she gives it the correct password. Utaho has no idea what the password could be, so she leaves the door for now, searching for clues. The foggy forest is a labyrinth, and Utaho finds herself constantly lost as she tries to navigate it. It makes sense why the village was impossible to find. As Utaho wanders, she keeps seeing hallucinations of a large, bloody head. Utaho needs to find her way out quickly, or she'll get lost in this forest forever. Finally, Utaho stumbles upon a well. It's too dark to see inside, but beside it is a blue flower with something buried under it. After she digs it out, Utaho finds a key. Okay, this is a good start. Utaho keeps going, finding 7 more wells with keys beside each of them. Once Utaho collects all the keys, she begins making her way back to the door, only to see what she thinks is Reno in the distance. Utaho calls out, to which Reno responds back. Utaho is bewildered, wondering what her sister is doing in the forest, but Reno only keeps repeating Big Sister over and over again, much like the taxi driver. Now don't forget, in this part, the clinic never happened, so Utaho doesn't know that her sister is actually dead. Angered, Utaho tells Reno to go home. It's too dangerous for her little sister to be in the forest. Suddenly, Reno's neck snaps as she screams out. Silence follows until Reno whispers, "It's your fault." Reno's lookalike then disappears. Utaho is silent, but she realizes the delusions and hallucinations are getting worse. She needs to hurry before it's too late. Navigating more confusing terrain, Utaho finally stumbles upon the Utaho village. She stops, taking in the sight of the place that started everything. She notices that it's suddenly dead silent. The bugs, which had been chirping and making noise, are now silent. Utaho carefully walks around the village, stumbling upon the Yamano residents. To Utaho's horror, she realizes that her ancestors used to live in the Utaho village. It explains why her family practiced the Utaho religion too. Though they left the village, they still practice the faith of the village. Exploring further, Utaho finds another home belonging to her family name. The house seems normal, but behind a sliding screen, Utaho finds a hidden room. Inside this hidden room, Utaho finds a book on the special terminology of the Utaho village. It begins with the Utaho faith and its god, Utaho. The Utaho god is a god of greed that sings songs of cleansing and healing. It constantly seeks out a host with a pure throat. An oni is a female demon who tries to steal the cleansing singing voice of the Utaho god. A well tower, or also known as the well of purification, is a well for the dead to escape from an oni or demons. To escape the oni, deceased villagers are placed into the well towers after death. Utaho's curse, or just the curse, was caused once a year when the Utaho god became enraged by having its singing voice or throat taken away by the oni. The villagers would sing a song to suppress the curse of the Utaho god. They called the song the God-Soothing Song. There's also a definition for uta, or throat, which ties into the throat awakening song. This song was the act of sacrificing the throat of a female child born to the Utaho village to the Utaho god. So it seems the Utaho village worships this Utaho god, protecting their god with protective mirrors in each household and well towers for their deceased loved ones, protecting their loved ones and their beloved god. However, once a year, the Utaho god would become enraged, spreading a curse as punishment unless a specific ceremony was performed, which includes singing a song to soothe the god and sacrificing a young girl from the village. This must have worked for hundreds of years, but right around when the Shinmachi reform project began to grow, something went horribly wrong with the ritual, spreading the curse to all the villagers. Because the villagers worked in every aspect of the Shinmachi reform project, the curse easily spread to other innocent bystanders who had no understanding of what was happening, until it killed off every living person who knew about the curse, going dormant since there was no one else to worship the god anymore and no one to appease it. So what changed so many years later? Did the grandmother do something? Was it Reno? How did the Utaho god escape? Well, we'll just have to continue on to learn more. Exploring further, Utaho finds the commandments of the village. The commandments are strange and very cult-like. Rules include not being allowed to leave the village except for special errands, which you must get a permit for, participating in all the rituals, those who refuse would be banished from the village, each household owning a protective mirror to help protect the Utaho god from demons, and all engagements and marriages happening within the village. And finally, all households had to construct at least one well, again to protect their god. Utaho then enters the Fushimi and Nagisa households. If these names seem familiar, they should. They were the last names of some of the people that went to the Shinmachi Reform Clinic for treatment. So right around when construction on these buildings was finished, many of the villagers began getting very sick. Entering the Nagisa household, Utaho goes straight back to the mirror at the back of the room. Around the mirror, the candles are lit. Odd, this village has been abandoned for decades. Next to the mirror is a diary from the eldest daughter. It reads, "What is wrong with me? Give me a piece of paper and a pen to hide with. I hate it when my mother is like that. There's nothing different about me. There's nothing wrong with me. I just want to live like everyone else. Is it because my name is Kaho? That doesn't matter. Help me. Somebody save me. Rescue me from this hell." It continues. But God speaks. He says, "You and I are very similar." No, you and I are completely different. But maybe you and I are the same. Once the truth is known, I will disappear. Disappear. I don't want to disappear. The note ends the same way as the note at the very beginning of the game does, saying, "There are some truths in this world that you should never learn. I learned one of those truths. Because I now know it, I will end my life. No one should get too close, because it is a cursed truth. You who read this, please don't search for the truth. And don't ask for it." So the note from the beginning was a girl from the village trying to ward anyone who was curious about the truth away from it. Sound familiar? Now, it's never answered for sure if this young woman is a young woman at the hotel, trying to keep anyone curious away from the truth. But it would make sense. She was a victim of the truth, of the curse. She got too close, and we can only imagine the consequences she faced because of it. And though we don't know how she died, if she did die by how she inferred, then there's a very good chance her body was never placed into a well, which would have made her an oni, or demon. She's trying to do now what she wasn't able to do in life. It also seems that Kaho, the girl in the note, was going to have her throat sacrificed to the Utaho god. She was most likely going to have a similar fate to Reno's, with the Utaho god speaking to and through her, and she didn't want that to happen. I believe that when Kaho did this, she threw off the ritual for the Utaho god. There was no throat awakening song to appease the god. In a fit of pure rage, the Utaho god sent a curse out to everyone in and associated with the village, which would include anyone associated with Shinmachi Reform Project. But that's not all. When Utaho goes behind the village, she sees a shrine. The secrets within the shrine reveal even more horrors as to what was happening. To get inside the shrine, Utaho uses the old keys she found in the locked room in her house. That tells us that the grandmother, who had disappeared after cleaning the shrine, was in fact coming to this shrine to clean it. So the grandmother was the only one doing the rituals to keep the Utaho god appeased. However, something must have gone horribly wrong in the shrine for everything that has happened in the game to happen. There are three hallways in the shrine, one to the left, one to the right, and one straight ahead. If Utaho goes left, she can find a hammer in one of the unlocked rooms. She can use this at the end of the hall to break down a strange wall that appears to have been forcefully filled in, just like the one in the hotel in the basement. A strange sight awaits her when she does this. It appears to be a woman, dressed completely in black, with her face disfigured. The empty, decrepit room around her is bathed in red. It seems that she was one of the young girls that was picked as a sacrifice for the Utaho god. After a moment, the lights go out and the room is now pitch black. Utaho cannot see anything in the room anymore. This must have been one of the secrets the villagers were trying to hide. And this also gives us a hint as to what was happening in the basement of the hotel. As disturbing a revelation as it is, Utaho must keep going. If Utaho backtracks to the right hallway, Utaho can enter what looks to be a storage room. Inside, she can find a few documents, including eerie posters about hands, human bodies, and throats. The throats poster is unsettling, with an image of a giant head with the text, "Throat/head and body are large." The giant head on the poster looks very similar to the giant head enemies that have been chasing Utaho around this entire game. The human body poster says, "Useless human being. Sell the body/model. Sell them for a high price." Again, a mannequin just like the one at the hotel and clinic is pictured. Another strange coincidence. Finally, the hands poster says, "Cut off hands and drain the blood," with a picture of, you guessed it, hands, similar to the one we saw in the clinic. So what does this all mean? Again, this is never really answered, but I believe that the throat ceremony and the ceremony in general is so much more than giving a young woman's throat to the Utaho god. I think a part of the ceremony is offering body parts to the Utaho god, including hands and head. The village's population was very small, so they would have needed to outsource, if you will. That's why Yuri Yamano joined the Reform Project. With a project this massive, there need to be a steady stream of unknowing tourists to accidentally disappear, all to feed their god. The enemies in the hotel and the clinic are victims of these rituals. The mannequin, the hand, the giant head, the mysterious young woman, all of them are victims of the Utaho village. All of them are trying to stop Utaho from learning more about the curse and spreading it. To stop her from facing a fate similar to theirs. If not a worse one. And while everything was fine at first with this plan of sacrificing innocent people, something went wrong. We know that because the curse spread throughout all of the village, as evidenced by the clinic's medical record chart. But what happened? Well, I believe the note from the beginning tells us exactly that. Kaho, the most important person in the ritual, the only person for the throat sacrifice, refused to participate in the ritual, and she made it so there was no way they could force her to join. Maybe the villagers tried to offer another girl up, but I think that the Utaho god specifically picked out Kaho, since it seemed to be speaking to her according to her diary. The Utaho god felt it and Kaho were the same. It felt a connection with Kaho somehow, and went into an uncontrollable rage when Kaho was not used for the ceremony. This is when the curse began to spread. It started with the villagers, the people who knew the truth behind their god in the ceremony, but it spread to anyone who got too close to the truth. Maybe that would explain too why the Utaho god let Utaho live when she was in her house. The god seems to want the eldest daughter of the family for some reason. Just like Kaho, seems to have a one-sided connection with Utaho. It wants Utaho to live and to come to the village. That's why it's using Reno's appearance to manipulate Utaho. It needs her to learn about the curse, about the truth of the village, so it can complete the ritual with her. But Utaho doesn't realize this, and how could she? As far as she's concerned, the curse targeted her family, not her in particular. Unfortunately, it seems Utaho won't learn the truth until it's too late. While Utaho was searching, she found a key to the archive room. So Utaho goes to that room, unlocking the door and stepping inside. However, once inside, she hears someone leave the room behind her. The same someone who took a taxi to the hotel before Utaho. The same someone who went missing. Utaho's grandmother. If she's here, she has to have some answers as to what has happened and how to stop it. Utaho follows after her, going back to the main hall. Utaho watches as her grandmother unlocks the only locked room remaining and continues to follow her. Inside the room is a large, empty hall. It's eerie, but if Utaho wants answers, she must continue forward. At the farthest end of the room, Utaho finally comes face to face with her grandmother. And in front of them, in the form of a familiar floating head, is the curse of the Utaho god. On either side of the floating head are protective mirrors. Utaho's grandmother begs for forgiveness, asking for help. Her research on how to break the curse must have been fruitless. Suddenly, the mysterious young woman from the hotel, who I believe to be Kaho, manifests in front of them. Oddly, the woman says, "I am not Utaho. I am. I am. I am." Then she says, "All blood relatives of Utaho must be wiped out." This goes back to my belief that the Utaho god wants to use Utaho in the ritual. It has selected Utaho, but if it's not Utaho, it would be someone in Utaho's bloodline. I believe this is because there are no other families from the village alive. Utaho's family is the last family from the Utaho village. If Utaho's bloodline dies out, there will be no one to do the god-saving ceremonies. Heck, there will be no one left to worship the Utaho god. For the curse to stop, Utaho and her bloodline must end. The mysterious young woman knows this, and that is why she goes on to break the mirrors in front of the curse of the Utaho god, the only thing protecting the Utaho god, before she disappears. Utaho's grandmother screams in horror, realizing what has happened before she runs out of the room. As Utaho follows her, leaving the hall and going back to the hole she created in the wall, standing next to a well tower is her grandmother. Utaho calls out to her, pleading with her, but Utaho is forced to watch in horror as her grandmother falls down the well without a sound. It seems the grandmother wanted to break the curse, but only focused on protecting herself from it. Utaho is left all alone, grief-stricken and traumatized. Now she is completely alone. If Utaho looks to her right, she finds what seems to be an altar. Hands are placed on pillars around a mirror, echoes of the sacrifices that were once committed there. The left side has the human anatomy mannequins, all surrounded by another mirror. Utaho even notes that they look just like the ones at the hotel. As she looks up ahead, decapitated heads are turned sideways on pillars and surround a mirror. This is the ritual room where they would sacrifice unknowing victims. This is the room Kaho stumbled upon. This is the truth Kaho learned, and she tried to stop it. And for the longest time, her valiant efforts worked. The curse became nothing but a distant rumor, until the grandmother somehow learned about the curse, spreading it to the Yamato household once again. Now the Utaho god wants Utaho for its ritual, and the only way to stop it is to completely eliminate Utaho's bloodline. The entire shrine is now covered in a red hue. There is nothing left for Utaho here. She's uncovered the truth, but by doing so, she's once again unleashed the curse. Utaho sought out the truth. She asked for it repeatedly, but how could she have ever guessed what she would help release? With nothing left here, Utaho leaves the shrine and returns to the Utaho village. This is how Utaho's story ends. So what is Utaho's fate? Well, it seems a figment of Rino appeared behind Utaho, telling Utaho not to forgive her. Though it isn't clear what exactly happens to Utaho, we know that the Utaho god was using Rino's appearance to manipulate Utaho, and we know that the Utaho god wants to use Utaho to live on. Though we don't know exactly what happens to Utaho after this, I think we can all agree her fate isn't a good one. For now, we can speculate. We know that the Utaho god wanted Utaho to come to the village to complete the ritual with her, sacrificing her throat. However, the Utaho god would need Utaho to live to continue to spread the Utaho curse. She's the only person alive that has any tie to the Utaho village in any way. So the Utaho god probably took Utano's throat, using her as a puppet to spread the Utaho religion and therefore gain more followers to follow and sacrifice to the Utaho god. In exchange, it would heal and cleanse those who needed it. We do get some definitive answers as to what happens to Utaho, but that isn't until the sequel of this game, The Curse of Utaho 2, which I will be covering the story and lore for, as well as how it connects to the first game, in my next video. Please make sure to keep an eye out for it to learn the entire story of Utaho no Tatari, including Utaho's true fate. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to our channel to be the first to know when that video drops. Until the next video, take care.